But first of all, by the way, the number one picture in all of the world is this right here. And that's the one that's Shofar. And that's my son-in-law. That's Tim Meisler. And photographer saw him. He's tall and slim. And he actually got, he said, can I take a picture of you? So they went up to the desert in Phoenix, Arizona, and took his picture. I said, son, you should have at least got some kind of, did you give it to you? No, he shook my hand and bought my lunch. But really, I've been in different parts of the world in my travels, and I'll see that picture there. I walked into a place even, you know, in Europe. They have a picture of that there. I said, that's my son-in-law. Oh, really? Yes, that's my son-in-law. And so that's, I just want to make mention of that. It's a time to seek God. There's some scriptures that I would like to share with you. The Bible says in the book of 1 Corinthians 15, 51, behold, I show you mystery. Y'all love mysteries. I know that when I was growing up, I would always have a mystery book. I would have a Bible and a mystery book right up next to my bed. And then when I became a widower, I was alone for 5 years asleep, and I would always get my Bible. But now I have my iPad. It has everything in there. And so, but it's interesting to know, and I don't know if you also have YouTube, or this one youth pastor has a bunch of youth in there. He says, can you hold up your Bibles? And everybody holds up their iPhones, because their Bibles are their iPhones and the iPad. So that was cute. Why was it? Behold, I show you mystery. I love the Word of God. I love the mystery within who it is. I love everything about God. We cannot know everything about God. I said that it's a time to seek God. Every day is a time to seek God. But more so when this is a time like this. More so. Because I believe in all of the scriptures that I read and hear all the scriptures. But when it says, thus saith the Lord said this, or the Lord God said, I command you, I pay a little bit more attention. So I believe every day is a time to seek God, but more so on the feast. The Bible says, behold, I show you mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. How many people have loved ones that have already gone to the Lord? There's exactly this power. I know we kind of, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. Just blink your eyes, you have to blink your eyes. Well, that is the moment of twinkling of an eye. At the last trump, by the way, and we're going to talk about the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. So in other words, our bodies will be changed someday, and I believe it's coming more and more. When I was in Bible college, it was so funny because preachers would go in there and talk about the coming of the Lord, and it was so real that between the fall semester and the spring semester, people would go get married because they thought, I wanted to experience married life before. And of course, that was, what, about 10 years ago? No. That was a long time ago. And but most of them are still married, I think they are. But I just want to share from my heart here, because this is a piece of God. And there's a mystery all behind it. And I love this about the Word of God. The Bible also says that he's not going to reveal, do anything without revealing to his people, to his prophets. So he's not going to do anything. So I believe things are happening. And my wife presently, she was really sick this past few weeks, but today she said, you know, I'm going to be in there tonight. By the way, if you come tonight, you know, make sure, we're going to try and set up a place right over here for EWC. It'll be packed out. It'll be packed out, so we'll have a lot of people. And we're quiet. And if you can't come, that's fine too. Celebrate at home. Or if you want to, you can look around on Facebook. We'll be live on Facebook. How many hits did we have on Facebook? 1,100. Over 1,100. 1,400. And it's amazing because I have other posts that we did that close to 2 million. And people are just texting, emailing me privately, pastors from all over. You know, the Lord has guided us. Told us about these things. And it's a command to the Lord. The Bible says it's not only for Jew but Gentile. Jews and Gentiles to celebrate the feast of God. And people say, well, you're going back to the law. Hold on here. If the law was so bad, God would have allowed King David to say, oh, how I love your law. Your law. so when we celebrate what the law and the Torah is, exactly the word law means Torah. Torah means pointing to God. And so that's what that means. So, I want to share with you from my heart, because my wife is not here and I can mention this. Before she passed away, she passed with cancer, and she was on her deathbed. And we knew that she was going to be passing, and we prayed and we fasted and everything with the Lord. There's a time. And God told she told me, says that God has told me it's my time to go. And then she prayed for me, and then she prayed for my future wife. I said, oh, never get married again. Yeah. Anyway, but then I was going to say that she closed her eyes, and then she passed into eternity. She said, Doc, I don't have a lot of drugs. And she experienced those things, and allowed me to share what she saw. First of all, she saw, she came and she told her mom, says, I can meet a guy that says he's my brother. And her mom starts crying, said, I've never told anybody. But when I was about to give birth, and I had a miscarriage, and oh my goodness, he said he's my brother. For those women that have had miscarriages, I'm here to tell you, I believe with all my heart that your child is in the heavens, and you will meet them someday, because life is life. And then she went on to say, experience different things, and she actually said, I saw a gigantic tree. The tree was reaching into the sky and came down with fruit. And I believe that that's the tree of life that she saw, because the Bible talks about the tree of life being reinstated. But then she said something. Everything is in Hebrew. She goes, the secrets of God, the mysteries of God are in the feast. Seek the feast. Celebrate the feast, because it's all tied into that. And she was sharing with all of these things. And so before she passed, she shared, oh my goodness. And that was like in March, and then of course, 1992, and then that Rosh Hashanah, I began Baruch HaShem, and I founded it. So that's where that came from. But I was going to say, there's a great mystery, and I believe that things are tied into that. And if you remember that some time ago, Isaac Rabbi and Yasser Arafat and Bill Clinton, they signed the Virginia Peace Plan, and then they said, hold on here. I don't know, we're going to wait for maybe like 5 days, 3 days, 2 days. What was he waiting for? Isaac Rabbi. And they signed it on Rosh Hashanah. And it's something about people sign peace pacts and different things. I believe that this is tied into the seven-year pact that the Lord is doing. And so the Bible says, for the Lord himself shall descend into heaven with the shout, with the voice of the archangel, and the trumpet of God, or the trumpet of God. Amen. Pastor Monty talked about the trumpet of God. And I believe the trumpet of God is going to be blown. With all my heart.
Is something that is amazing. I think I shared with you, I don't know if I shared with you.
HaShem. But I remember Kuman, those of you know Kuman, he's working all the time. I praise the Lord. Me too. And he said, he calls me, Dad, Dad, I need something from Kuman. So I went to say, oh, go get it. It's in my wallet. And he got a AAA card. And he came back, oh, where is this? Dad says, I've heard of AA, Alcoholics Anonymous, but you must have really had it bad. You have AA. So he didn't know what that was. For you, someone put me in the dead over something as a thief in the night. For when they are saying peace and safety, then sudden destruction comes. And then said, but you brothers are not foreigners, that day shall overtake you as a thief. So in other words, the Bible is going to give hints to those people that are believers. I'm not a gatesetter, nor do I say that this is going to take place. But I do believe that if Yeshua could prove the scriptures and was conceived on a feast, he was born on a feast. He cleansed the temple on many questions. He died on a feast. He resurrected on the feast of first fruits. The Holy Spirit fell out on Pentecost. That's Shavuot. That's when the trumpet shall sound. But when is the trumpet sounded in the feast of God? Number one, it sounded most on Rosh Hashanah or Yom Teruah. It's a feast of trumpets. Second, it sounded on the feast of Sukkot. It's found on the feast of Sukkot. It's found on Yom Kippur. I was there in Jerusalem and they sound at 3 o'clock, they blow the shofar at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And they blow the shofar on Pentecost, just like the scripture that Pastor Monty read in the book of Exodus. And it's blown at different times. So, can you ask a question? Yes, sir. Yes, the question is, are any of these considered the last trump? And what it's called a tekiya hagadol, or a tekiya godola. It'll be this evening, or the last trump is always the one that goes. And there's a kosher way to blow the shofar. It's actually in scriptures. Allow me to share it. It's just like a crying out. Rabbi Crumble actually gave me the names of them. There's 9 calls. By the way, this is year 5779. There's 9. And the last is called the last trump. And it's blown on several of the feasts. Not only of Kippur, not only of the Feast of Tabernacles, but on Shavuot and another. So it's a mystery. It's a mystery. I love that. But maybe the Lord can return on Rosh Hashanah. I don't know. And I'm not a gatesetter. And he will send his angels with a loud trumpet call. Here it is again. And they shall gather his elect from the four winds, from one end to the other. And this is Rosh Hashanah in the year 5779. Rosh Hashanah. That's what it is. There are 7 annual holy days, beginning with the Passover, ending with the last great day of the end of the Tabernacles. So if you really look at the book of Daniel, everything is time. I remember when I was in seminary, and then not only Bible college, we go to seminary for graduate school, and the professors say, we don't know what these numbers are. But with every, 1,300, so if you count from one piece to another, probably falls right smack on them. But Shana Tova, that means Happy New Year. And the Lord spoke unto Moshe, saying, speak unto the children of Israel, saying, in the 7th month, in the 1st day of the month, shall we have a Shabbat, memorial of the Lord and the trumpets, a holy convocation. The word holy convocation is Midrash Kodesh, which means it's a holy rehearsal. A rehearsal for what? Maybe it is. It's a rehearsal for everything. If Yeshua is conceived on a feast, he was born on a feast. And understand, when I worked with the Israeli government, I had an opportunity to sit in a yeshiva, and they said, no believers in Messiah. I sat in there. And they said, the reason that we don't believe in Yeshua, they don't call him Yeshua, is because he does not fulfill the faith. And I've determined my heart to prove them wrong. And that's when I started studying the feast and we began the congregation of Hashem. It's a holy rehearsal. But then, let's look into the fulfillment and the recognition of the New Testament. Are y'all ready? Y'all remember what happened? It was on this particular day, because in the time of the Feast of Trumpets, it's new. It's the time of healing. You cast your bread upon the waters. And you said, in fact, Rabbi, you're also going to be casting the bread upon the waters Monday morning, right? Or Monday evening. Monday evening, you'll be casting the bread upon the waters. And this is a fulfillment of scriptures. But in this particular time, Yeshua, actually, in the book of John, so come with me to the book of John, chapter 5. John chapter 5 says, and there was a feast of the Jews. And if you write this down, this is the Yom Torah, the Rosh Hashanah. If you put it, and Yeshua went up to Jerusalem, and there was a Jerusalem with the chief gate of rule, which is called the Hebrew Bethesda, and the five porches. And there, these led a great multitude of sick people, blind, lame, paralyzed, waiting for the movement of the water. So when you cast your bread upon the water, the movement of the water, on Rosh Hashanah, it was customary that the waters had healing power. So they get all excited around. So there, and what happened to this guy? He was paralyzed. For an angel looked down at a certain time into the pool and stirred the waters. And whoever stepped in first after the stirring of the water was made well of whatever disease he had. And I believe in this. Don't believe in this? I believe in the Word of God. Now a certain man was there who had an infirmity for 38 years. Well, he was sick for 38 years. That's a long time, you guys. 38 years. When Yeshua saw him lying there, he knew that he had already been in that condition a long time. He said to him, do you want to be made well? That was the man's answer. Yes, sir, I have no man to put me in the pool when the water stirred up. But while I am coming, another steps down before me. I want to be first. Yeshua said to him, rise up, take up your bed and walk. And 10 days later, immediately, the man was made well, took up his bed and walked. That day was the Shabbat, was the Sabbath. So anytime there's a Jewish holiday, it is always a feast. So whether it falls on a Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, that day is a feast. It's called Shabbat. And that's for this reason, the Jews were persecuting Jesus because he was doing these things on the Sabbath. And you can't do this on the Sabbath. They have no idea what the Sabbath is for. Sabbath is a meeting between God and man. Now I believe to worship the Lord on the Sabbath. And I also believe that we worship the Lord every day. Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. Yeshua, he resurrected on the first day of the week, the Bible says. So I believe we can worship the Lord every day. Rosh Hashanah is called Rosh Hashanah for us. It is. It's called Rosh Hashanah. It means the beginning of the year. Rosh meaning head, or first Hashanah of the year. It's called the head, or the beginning of the year. But the Lord never calls it Rosh Hashanah. Why is that? Why? Now think about this. Why doesn't the Lord call it, this is the beginning of the year? Why doesn't the Lord call it? You have no idea? This is why. It's because he has no beginning. He has no end. And so another man, this could be our beginning. This is going to be the beginning of the creation of the world. But to him, hey, I've been there, done that, I'm before that time. So that's why I've got crossed this feast, Yom Torah, the memorial of the blowing of the trumpets, the holy convocation. So he calls it the Feast of Trumpets, Yom Torah, because that he sounds, and that's what he listens to. So the Lord himself will call it Yom Torah. But Passover is called Passover for us. But not God. He doesn't call it Passover. Why? It's because nothing passed over him. He's God. He was established. He called, when HaShem is using the feast, he calls it unleavened bread. And so the feast of unleavened bread, because that's what he experiences. So whatever you say, and the feast of unleavened bread, he talks about unleavened bread. For us, it's Passover. But for him, it's unleavened bread. And the 15th day of the same month is the feast of unleavened bread to the Lord. Can you see that difference here? It's to the Lord. So, how does this man know letters? I just want to share with you all something here. Because the Bible says in the book of John, it says that they were sent, how does this man know letters? And I'm going to show you a few things in the letters. It says, what is a set of letters? It's rearranging the letters of the Torah for a deeper insight. It's so wonderful. Because every time God mentions a word, or the first time a letter is mentioned, from then on, it's as a precedent. Like the word Elohim, it starts with an Aleph. That means strong and mighty. So from here on up, you know, you look at different words with that Aleph, and that's what it starts with. That, you know, to create. So all these things, it comes from a home. You know, body, you know, all these things, it's a bodysuit, we arrange the letters, use a larger or letters to do these things. Now about the middle of the feast, Yeshua went out in the temple and taught. This is the Feast of Tabernacles, which is coming up. How does this man know letters? Have you never studied? And they're saying, how does this man know letters? And that was the Yeshua. Actually, it was a study of letters that got me so interested in these things. When I worked for the Israeli government, I had an opportunity to stay at Rabbi Merrick Cohen's, Dr. Rabbi Merrick Cohen, one of the most renowned rabbis in all of Israel. And he had, they call them flats. They're called, it's apartments that they've had for centuries. And when we wake up, we'd see the Western Wall right there in Jerusalem. Amazing. And we'd stay up till 2 or 3 in the morning studying the scriptures. And he gave me insights that I shared last Friday. And, oh my goodness, it is so amazing. By the way, this is the celebration, the anniversary. Remember when Yeshua was 40 days in the desert? And he comes back. This is the anniversary when he comes back. And he stands in front of everybody. Before the sentence, don't tell anybody, don't tell anybody. But now he proclaims. Now he makes a public proclamation that he is the Messiah. Wow, that's something tied into this weekend. This weekend is really, really important, you guys. Hope you see it. How does this man know letters that we've never studied? Well, he knows letters just because he's an author. He is the Torah. He is the Word of God. And so he knows it. Yeshua answered him and said, my teaching is not mine, but he who sent me. If anyone wills to do his will, you shall know concerning the teaching, whether it is from God, whether I speak from my own Lord. So allow me to share with you some of the things that perhaps he taught. I don't know, but there's some insights that I've learned from the rabbis in the past. In the beginning, God created. The Hebrew says, Bereshit Bara Elohim. Ad HaShemayim Ve'aretz. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The one word Bereshit is a word in the beginning. So God could have, you know, in his infinite wisdom, he got that one word that's so explosive. Because you rearrange that one letter, it has an entire message of salvation. That's where sons and daughters and residents above the coming of Messiah. David, how many some other words that it has in that one word rearranged? What are some of the words that it has in your language in that one word?
It could be
the lamb, the lion, all these things.
Daughter
said fire, covenant, greed. It's all these things are in that one word. But what I'm going to share with you, it also says in the first teacher, God created the heaven and the earth. When is the first teacher? Tonight is that day. So see the significance of it in the first of Tishri. So in the beginning, that's where we are. Yes, it's also what?
Create,
of course, Baba. In the beginning, mercy. You rearrange the letters. It's on the first of Tishri. It actually says that, which is tonight. Isn't that amazing, you guys? So when you see this, so this is the anniversary of the creation of the world tonight. Wow. Can you praise the Lord for that? This is where God does things. That's why the stirring of the waters, casting, that's why reconciliation and marriages and healing takes place. So all this is this. But also it says that it came to pass in the 6th and the first year, in the first month and the first day of the month, the waters were dried up. We're in the year what? 5779. But we're getting close. There was like 225 years lost in captivity. We really don't know. But God knows. But you add that to 5779, we're getting really close. Year 6000. Really close. And so that's why, according to Jewish theology, because of this scripture here, that they believe that the Messiah will come in the year 6000. Which we're getting really close to. Who's got a calculator? Can you help me out here? We're on 5779, and then let's say 220. Are you serious? $5.99?
Yeah.
Oh my goodness. Very, very likely, y'all. In fact, that's what I'm saying. I'm going to enter it. We're going to read to your 5780 next year. By His grace, 7 is, of course, God's remember, and 8 is new beginnings. So possibly the Lord coming. I'm not a date setter, but I know He's coming. On the first day, when the waters were dried from the earth, and Noah removed the covenant ark. Remember? In Genesis 8:4, it actually was the anniversary when He resurrected from the dead. It actually shows that. So here, it's right ahead. But if you look, it actually says, on the first day of the first one, that means the first of Tishrei. But you rearrange those letters, and it says, on Rosh Hashanah. Oh my goodness. So He stepped foot on dry land. Tonight is that anniversary of that time. Can you praise the Lord for that? Yes.
I just read that a bred heifer was born and just recently found to be without spot and blemish. How does that fit in?
Amazing question. For those of you that didn't hear me, said, I just heard that the red heifer was born. A God that's very tied into prophecy. Robert Bibber raised his hand this Christ Friday and said, did you see that? The red heifer was just born. And the name of the red heifer is called Kosher. Now, why is red heifer, was it prophesied? Is because they cannot dedicate the temple at all until a red heifer is born. Kosher red heifer. And then without blemish, and it was born with this past week or two. But now, it has to be 200 years old before they do anything. So, you got to have time to go call your, get the neighbors and your friends, and let's get things right. So I'm just saying, if you're exactly right, the red heifer is born. It's all over the internet. It's explosive because the Bible talks in the book of Numbers. In order for them to dedicate the tabernacle at that time, then later on the temple, they need to get a red heifer and burn the ashes and offer it to the Lord, symbolic of the sacrifice of the sign. So very good question. Amen. Yes?
Last Tuesday.
Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. Thank you. If you can send that to me. I need to mention that tonight. Thank you very good. Thank you very much. Blow the shofar. You come to His presence because the blow the shofar actually scares away the enemies. Can I share with you? When I worked with this radio, it was amazing because I would hear story after story. One of the stories was that they were in battle with the Egyptians, and they were in a certain spot. And in that spot, the Egyptians were on one hill, and they were on the other. And they said, you know, we're going to do something. He said, one guy said, you know what, this is a very same spot. That the sun came out, and everybody put their shields up. The sun shined down on them, and they started shouting and blowing shofars and everything. It scared the enemy. They bumped into each other. Remember that scripture in the Bible? So this is the very same spot. So then in the morning, says that means that in the morning that the sun is going to come up. And what they actually did, they put all the radar things, they polished them up at night, and when it came up, the sun came up, the right spot, it shined down, they shined down on them, and they blew their shofars and the trumpets and made all the, and the Egyptians actually got up and sort of bumping to each other and going this way and that way. So it was fulfilled in the scriptures and also during the 73 Yom Kippur War. Can you praise the Lord for that? So we know that He was present, blowing in the shofar, because the Bible says that. And He's appointed times. Tonight is appointed times. And the Lord spoke into Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel, saying, concerning the feast, Lord, you shall have holy convocations. These are the Jewish feasts. Lord didn't say that. These are my feasts. The Bible says, these are my feasts, says the Lord. And blow the shofar, and also you come into His presence to rejoice in His presence. There's a time where He said, hallelujah, praise the Lord, blessed be His name. We lift up our voices, we lift up our song and praise, and this is, we blow the shofar to do these things. Amen. So shout joyfully to the Lord, all the earth. Bring forth in song, rejoice, and sing praises. Thank you, Lord, with the harp, with the sound of the song, with the trumpets and the sound of the shofar. Shout joyfully before the Lord, the King. So the hallelujah, hallelujah. So what Pastor Monty was doing, though he knew it, or he didn't know it, he says, everybody stand up and shout with one voice, with the trumpet. Say, Jesus. That's exactly a very biblical thing to do on this day. So I knew that he knew it ahead of time. And plan. That's very, very good. So he was, this is a very good thing. Blow the shofar and to receive a blessing in his presence. When you hear the shofar call, that's actually a blessing. So this King, you're going to go home. Not only are you going to be blessed, but all your family is going to be blessed.
Amen.
Amen. Because of you. You're that source. You're that conduit, okay? You're that conduit. Amen. Amen. So when this, every one of you, that you hear the shofar, David's going to be blessed. But he's that conduit to bless his family, his grandkids. Maybe one of his kids are going to run away this way that way. But blessings are going to come because of you. You're hearing the shofar. Now perhaps you cannot make it tonight. You know, go on, listen to us or hear the shofar or go on the website. But spend time tonight about 7:45 is when the sun goes down. Just get together with the family. We're going to pray. Amen. To receive a blessing in this presence. And they heard the sound of the Lord. Boy, I hear when you read that in Hebrew, you know, Adam and Eve sinned. I don't have time to show you now, but in the future, they sinned at noon. They ate the fruit. The Bible never says apple. I believe I know what it is, but I'll tell you later on. But they ate the fruit. And then at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, God comes on the day. They heard the sound. When you hear that in the Hebrew, it's like a trumpet. Woo!
I can't really see it, no. The tekiah, though, is just one note. And the oneness, it reminds us that there's just one God that we serve. The shevarim is three notes. The shevarim is three notes, and that reminds us that that we're to love the Lord our God with all of our heart, all of our soul, all of our strength. And it's, as we hear these sounds, the teruah is nine short notes. And it could remind us of several things. One of those being the fruit of the Spirit, that God's calling the fruit to ripen and to produce in our lives. So, I mean, there's a lot of different symbolisms and things that they mean. But again, tekiah, one note. Shevarim, three notes. Teruah, nine notes. And teruah is the actual day that the day is called Yom Teruah, the day of alarm, the day of shouting, the day of blasting. And that's actually what the day is actually called by that particular sound on that one.
Thank you. And then the very last passion is the last, it's called the last trump. Remember the shofar, that's what Pastor Monty, you remember the shofar, call to worship, remembering our past victories, bring spirit to the enemy, call for repentance, a call for the dead to rise. Calling for a bridegroom, announcement of the King, you know, ushering in the Messiah. That last trumpet sound, the last loud trumpet sound, blow the shofar. And blow the shofar, if I can have my priest to come forward.